So welcome to our Saturday morning session. So today it is indeed Saturday. And now we will discuss a little bit about the heritage of India. And the title is Glimpses of Vast Heritage of India, because one can only get the glimpse. It's such a vast indeed that it is difficult to fathom and go deep into that. What I intend to do is that in this session and the next session, we will take an overview of this vast heritage, and thereafter we can decide where to go in deep. Then we will choose that particular part, and then we will go deeper into that particular aspect of our heritage. Now, we will start our national anthem, emblem. Satyameva Jayate, this is what is written here. This has been taken from one of the pillars of Ashoka in Sarnath, in Madhya Pradesh, where this temple is located. Not Sarnath, sorry. There's another name of that, but where this pillar is located.
Is it Sachi?
Sachi, yes. This is Sachi. Now, Satyameva Jayate, this wording comes from Mundak Upanishad. Mundak Upanishad, part 3, Mundak 3, chapter 1, verse number 6, that is 3:16, gives this particular wording in Sanskrit. Satyameva Jayate. It talks about that truth always triumphs, but then it talks about the Devyan path, Devyan mark, which has also been discussed in Bhagavad Gita, but this has been discussed in greater detail in Upanishads, that once you travel after your death on Devyan mark, then you reach the abode of the Almighty, and that is actually the greatest symbol of the truth. Then you realize what this world is and what the truth is. So basically it tells us that what is the underlying truth in this world. Whatever we see in this world is not the truth, because this is a transient existing fact, transiently existing fact. It keeps changing constantly. Every millisecond it changes. But there is an underlying truth behind that change. It's like the screen. The truth is like the screen on which the movie appears. The movie keep rolling on that screen, or on the TV screen we keep the pictures keep rolling, or you keep changing all the time the channels. The same screen depicts different variety of pictures. The same way in this universe, there's one single screen of the truth on which everything else appears. And that is the background on which the sansar plays, the world plays. Therefore, this is called the truth of all the truths. This has also been described in a different way in Keno Upanishad, but that we will talk separately on some other occasion. Now we will go to one of the very, often quoted Sanskrit verse, which is quoted more by politicians and less by others, but let us understand the meaning of this. अयम निज परो वेति गणना लघु चेतसाम उदार चरिता नाम तु वासुदेव कुटुंबकम्। अयम निज, दिस इज माइन, परो दिस इज योवर्स, परो इज दूसरे, समबडी एल्स इज। अयम निज परो वेति, दिस इज माइन, दिस इज योवर्स। वेति मीन्स दैट काइंड ऑफ थिंकिंग टेंडेंसी, दिस काइंड ऑफ काउंटिंग। So this is mine, this is yours, this kind of counting is done by Laghu Chetsam, those who have very low level of thinking. Laghu is small, Chetsam is Chet is Chetna. So the level of their consciousness is very low. Those people think in that way. And they count. They count that this is mine, this is yours. Because their thinking and their consciousness is very low. Udar Charitanam, the people who have what you call magnanimous character, the people who have well-developed character, for them, the Vasudev, the whole earth, is like a family. So this is what this meaning of this verse is. This verse looked very utopian some years ago. People thought that this is, you know, just in the form of what you call ideals or morals and ethics. This has nothing to do with reality in the world. But now everybody has realized that this is not so. It is absolutely true. We have seen after the coronavirus that there is nothing mine, nothing yours, everything can spread so fast and that everything belongs to everything. So the whole world is one single family. This has become very clear after the corona crisis. Even otherwise, before corona crisis, this was visible to some extent because of globalized trading patterns and globalized tourism, globalized families. But that was still not very clear. People still thought that though my family is here in US, in Canada, in Australia, but still, you know, it was a dividing factor. But today, this coronavirus has explained to us very well that this is the truth, Vasudeva Kutumbakam is the real truth. This has also been explained now by what we call climate change. You can see there may be flooding in one part and fire in another part and snow in another part. But ultimately, that fire or that flooding or that snow affects every human being who is living on this earth. And this will become more pervasive in the coming years. There may be rains in the Himalayas, but the whole of India and China could be inundated because of that. And because of inundation of India and China, other countries may be affected. The food production may be affected. The navigation may be affected. The whole, you know, what you call food security could be endangered. So all these issues are now becoming clearer to the humanity that this verse was not an utopia, but this is a practical happening which we can see with our own eyes today. So I thought I'll start with these two verses first, Satyameva Jayate and Ayam Nij Paroveti Ganana Laghu Chetsam Udar Charitanam Tu Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Now, if we go back to the map of India, let's go back to the time of Mahabharata. Mahabharata, the battle of Mahabharata happened sometime approximately 5,153 years. That is based on what we call the position of different planets, which have been explained, and many writings which have appeared after Mahabharata, including the writings of Aryabhatta and Bhaskaracharya. These great mathematicians and astrologists have given a lot of evidence about the what we call measuring the time, how to measure time and how to move. But that measurement we will take separately when we go deeper into what we call the measurement of time by Indian writings, in Indian writings, starting from atomic time, going right up to the life of Brahma. which is equal to 311 trillion and 40 billion years. We will talk about that later. But this is how the India looked during that period, 5,150 years ago. A large part of Afghanistan, of course, the whole of Pakistan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, and Sri Lanka, they were Nepal, parts of Tibet, they were part of India. And this is how the map of India looked that time. Now, this spiritual and economic traditions of India, they lasted approximately up to 12th century AD, and thereafter they started decaying. There was a decay which started after 12th century, and the decay was very, very fast, but we will talk about that subsequently. Now, this is how this map has, I have taken this from the UNESCO website. The UNESCO website depicts the Silk Route and the Spice Route. And this, where my mouse, you know, my mouse is, this was the most, I would say, frequented trade route of the world at that time. That was the time of around 14th, 15th, 13th century, when the most of the production centers were either India or China, and the trading routes were primarily through Indian Ocean, going to the Arab countries and then further going up to the European nations. So this is how the trading routes were at that time. And because India and China were, particularly India was very, very rich, that is why Europeans were looking for traveling to India by sea route. The known sea route was already known, but it was too difficult for people to travel and particularly to carry the wealth. So they were looking for the sea route, which is easier. And that is why, let me take this, Christopher Columbus tried to come to India in 1492. But unfortunately, he landed on the other side. He took east as west and west as east. So he landed up in the west and he reached the Caribbean and then the Latin American countries. And precisely, he thought that this was India and those people were named Indians. So even today, all those people in the Caribbeans are called Indians. And so are the Americans, what we call Native Indians. The word India comes from there because Christopher Columbus thought that he has reached India and he named them Indians. So this is how the Western world actually wrote the history, and they named all of them as Indians. But after Christopher Columbus realized that he was not in India, he was in Latin America, Vasco da Gama started his journey from Portugal. And he finally reached India. The latest, you know, stories tell that he reached Africa. And in South Africa, there were already many Indians who were living at that time. And some of them guided him how to reach India by sea route. So there are some recent videos which will depict you that who guided Vasco da Gama to India and how he finally reached India at the end of 15th century. So this is why they wanted to come to India. They wanted to come to India because India was a rich country. Nobody wants to go to a poor country. Even today when we go as tourists, we always select the countries which are attractive. Either there is a natural wealth or there is a physical wealth or there is something else. Nobody wants to go to the poorer sections of the world. So this is was the region that Vasco da Gama was in India, and why the Western powers were looking for India. Because a lot of commodities, particularly the spices, the silk, the handicrafts, the clothings, and the, you know, all these diamonds and precious stones, they were going in large quantity from India to Europe, and they wanted to discover the place which is producing all these things and which is sending in such large quantities to those countries. And that is why they wanted to discover India. Now, I'm taking this chart from a book written by Angus Madison. He's an American. He wrote a book, it was not long ago, he's still alive. He wrote a book about, I think, 20 years ago. And he took the world trade from year zero, as per the Christian era, up to 2008. And you can see here very easily that India was the most dominant power in the world in terms of trading. The trade controlled by India was approximately 33-35%. And until the year 1600, India was the most dominant trading and manufacturing power in the world. The biggest economic power, you can say. From year zero up to approximately 1550. And then China became stronger than India. And then India and China dominated the world trade till approximately, then India again became number one up to 1730, 1740. India was the most dominant power in the world trade because India was the most industrialized country in that sense. And we were controlling approximately somewhere between 35-25% of global trade. And then China was controlling somewhere around the same, 25-30%. So most of the world trade was controlled by India and China during this period. Then slowly, slowly after colonization, India's share started diminishing. You can see this graph coming down constantly, coming to a point then we were almost 4% of the global trade. Or 3.5% in 73. And we were one of the lowest one that time. And in the same period, the Europeans, they started going up. They started going up from here. This is the European chart. And the Americans started going up from here, 18th, 19th century onwards. So they became the dominant powers. And today, the Europe, US, and China are controlling almost similar share of trade. This is up to 2008, sorry. Today, otherwise, I think Europe has gone down again to some extent. But these are the three major trading powers. India remains in the range of about 4-5% of global trade. So this is what Indian prosperity, Indian heritage shows us, that India was one of the greatest economic power in the world until about 1720 AD, for controlling the world trade for 1700 years of the current Christian era. Now we will go on all this separately. This is just a chart that what all originated in India. These are some of the universities, the ruins of the most ancient universities in the world. We will look at them slowly, slowly, one by one. Now let us go. There was a question which was asked in the last session that we should know what is Shruti and what is Smriti. So we will go into that a little later. First, I just want to outline some of the important inventions or discoveries which India did and which became global heritage slowly, slowly. So Vedas, the first thing is the most ancient written text anywhere in the world is Rig Veda. There's no text older than Rig Veda. This is now universally accepted all over. though the Western people date it only around 2500 to 3500 BC, but I will tell you later on that it is at least 10,000 years BC, at least. Then astronomy. If we come to the knowledge of India, the world was called Khagol, here written Khagol. Kha means the entire universe. Like Khag is also Pakshi, because it roams into the universe, into the space. And Khagol, Khagol means the universe which is gol, which is, you know, circular. So they, our ancestors knew thousands of years back in time that the universe was, you know, circular. And this was also called Brahmand because it was like in the shape of egg and it was given birth by Brahma. So it was also called Brahmand. But astronomy is a science which actually originated in India. Just to explain to you, if you look at our system of Janampatri and Panchang, you can go back to generations and you will find Janampatris were made at the time of birth for all of us in ancient times. And they all have Navgraha. In that chart which shows your Janampatri, Navgrahas are clearly shown. So our ancestors long time back knew about Navgrahas. And in what you call Aryabhatiya, that is the text which has, you know, could be found in its original version. Aryabhatiya is preserved in its original version even today. Aryabhatiya was written in the 5th century AD, approximately 460-470 AD. And that text talks about all the astronomical feats. And that text is available. I have the copy of the text on my laptop. If you read this, you will find fascinating. What all is written there is unbelievable. But there was a text even before Aryabhatta that was called Surya Siddhant. That text is supposed to be at least 700 to 800 years before Christ, that is BC. Though some people say that it is approximately 10,000 BC, but let us not go into the debate of the time period. But it is a fact that Surya Siddhant as well, Surya Siddhant is the oldest written text on astronomical aspects of the universe anywhere. There is no text older than that on astronomical aspects. Even Aryabhatiya, even if we ignore Surya Siddhant, Aryabhatiya is the second oldest text on astronomical aspects of our universe. So both these texts are absolutely authentic. The original text of Surya Siddhant is also available with me. It's so difficult to understand it, but it's a fantastic text. If some mathematician wants to get a copy, I can send them the copy, because it's really worth reading and understanding. I have the English version along with the Sanskrit version. So these texts clearly indicate that astronomical knowledge, the knowledge of various, you know, planets, various stars, and their system, how they worked in the universe, was very well known to our ancestors long, long time back. This time, when we knew all that, if you compare that with the Western knowledge, the Western world were still fighting in the 17th and 18th century, telling that the Earth is the center of the solar system and sun revolves around the Earth. They also were telling that the Earth is flat and it's only 6,000 years old. Because in Bible, there's some reference that earth was created 4000 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. So they thought that earth was only 6000 years old. So these were the facts known to the Western world till approximately 17th century, end of the 17th century. While the knowledge in India on these issues goes back to at least 7th century BCE before Christ, that is 3000 years from today at least. The Surya Siddhant which describes these things. Now let me also give you an example on that. Now we have these days of the week which are named after the planets. This Ravivar, then Somvar, Mangalvar, Budhvar. So there are 7 planets here. We are also treating moon as planet, though in the modern world they call it, you know, satellite of the earth, but we treat it as a planet. So there are 7 planets there and 7 days of the week. These were named in Sanskrit, named after these planets. And when the Sanskrit language with these weeks traveled to the other parts of the world, the other parts of the world also adopted the same system. 7 days in a week to begin with, and then the same name of the planet appearing for each day of the week. Like Monday is Moon's day, we call it Somvar, Som's day. Tuesday is Mars day, and it is Mangal, Mangal's day. So you can count all the 7 days, and you will see in all the languages of the world, they have been named after the same planets because their origin lies in Sanskrit, where they were named by our ancestors. We don't know how many thousand years back in time. Because when we will discuss about the counting of time, which I will come at some stage in our presentation, not today, but next presentation, then we will understand the wheel of time and how it operates and how vast it is. So it is not easy to estimate the wheel of time today unless we go into those details. But right now I just wanted to give a glimpse of some of the ancient Indian heritage. So first we started with Vedas, then astronomy. Now I have not gone into details on Vedas, but we will do that separately. Now mathematics. If you read Aryabhatiya, you will be so much fascinated by what he has written in that 5th century AD version. And if you read Surya Siddhant, you will be even more fascinated. There's so profoundly mathematical texts. Aryabhatiya has even converted the entire numericals into alphabets. The 36 alphabets of Sanskrit language and the 16 vowels have been used to explain that system. I will put that slide, not today because I don't have it on this presentation, I have it on a separate presentation. So I will put up that slide and you will be fascinated that he never used the numericals, he used the text. And he used such a simple text that simply writing have with two, that is have, will denote millions and trillions of numbers. And that is how he invented what you call, vowels and alphabets for numericals. But he also talks about the value of pi. He talks about all the, sine functions. He talks about various geometric shapes. He talks about the fact that the earth is round and it is rotating on its axis. and it's also revolving around the sun. He also talks that the sun is the center of the solar system. So all these things, basically the astronomy and mathematics, they are closely interlinked. Without mathematics, you cannot understand astronomy. And without astronomy, you cannot understand mathematics fully. That is why I often say that this whole universe is mathematics. And that is the reason it works in a very precise way. If it were not mathematics, the suns and stars would have collided and the whole universe would have been destroyed anytime. But it has been created in such a mathematical way, in a very precise way, that it has survived and it will survive all those trillions of years, which is the life of this universe. And it is designed to survive that life, as human body is designed to survive for approximately 100 years. The same way universe has been designed to survive for trillions of years. So this is also the Aryabhatiya, for the first time used the concept of zero. And that is very clear in his verses. I will show you. I think I put up one of his articles, which I had written, one of his articles on his writing I had written. I had put up on Atmabodh, and it would be worthwhile reading that article, that he invented zero. Maybe zero was also invented in Surya Siddhanta. I don't know yet, because I have to read that carefully. But definitely Aryabhatta's writing, Aryabhatiya, clearly shows that he invented zero, and that he invented, he knew the value of pi up to the four digits. And then he did all these, you know, geometric shapes and sine functions and various other mathematical truths. And then he also talks about Kal Chakra. There are four parts in Aryabhatiya. One of them talks about time. So this is about little bit about mathematics. And this is one of the regions that the first satellite which was launched by India was named after Aryabhatta. And the second was named after Bhaskara. Bhaskaracharya came into the 6th century, about 100 years after Aryabhatta. And he is also one of the greatest mathematicians of all times. Now, the numericals 1 to 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, those numericals were also invented in India. And that is why in Europe they are called Indo-Arabic numericals, because they were born in India, then they traveled to Arab world from here, because the route to Europe is via Arab world. And then they reached, you know, the European countries. Because Europe only had the so-called Roman numericals. You must have seen all those Roman numericals in the clock also, where it becomes highly complicated to go beyond even 1000. So the numericals which we invented in India, and zero which was invented by our ancestors, made it extremely easy for anybody to go into, you know, the mathematical calculations without any problems. So this is what a brief commentary on the mathematical traditions of India. Then we talk about language. Now it is already clear that Rig Veda is the first written text in the world anywhere, and that is written in Sanskrit. And there is no other language which is older than Sanskrit. That becomes very clear here. But not only that, Sanskrit is the primarily mother of all languages. Indo-European family of languages has been born from Sanskrit. Now, if you look at the words, for example, I have a list of about 400 words in English and French, which have their direct origin in Sanskrit. You can link them clearly. For example, we call Sant in English, they call Saint. In French, they call Saint. And in Spanish, they call also Saint, something like that. So this is one example, but you can talk about two, for example. We call it Dwe in Sanskrit. In French, they call it Dwe. In Spanish, they call it Dos. In English, they call it Two. We call Three. Tre is the Sanskrit word for three, Tre. In French, they call it Trois. In Spanish, they call it Tres. And in English, they call it Three. So you can go, you know, up to nine, you will have the same thing. Navam in English, for example, Navam is the word in Sanskrit. And then it becomes nine in English. There is a long, long list of words which have direct origin in Sanskrit. And not only that, Sanskrit is the most sophisticated language, closest to mathematics anywhere in the world. One root word in mathematics, in Sanskrit, for example, you take root pat. Pat means to read. Or gach. Gach means to go. Now that root word has 90 different variations with tensage and numerical. That is, Sanskrit has what we call singular, then two, and then plural. Similarly, it has first person, second person, and the third person. It has 16 vowels. Vowels are the original sounds. This is the only language in the world which has 16 vowels. No other language has that. So it has the most elaborate structure which any language can ever have. Even the nouns in Sanskrit, for example, my own name or anybody's name, would be converted into 24 parts, 24 different parts. They call them vibhakti. So every single word has so many what you call different forms, because they wanted to give precision to the expression which we are making through the language. They did not want to have many ambiguities in the language. The language is an expression of our thoughts, but all the time we feel that we are not able to express our thoughts fully because of lack of words in the language. Sanskrit is one language which can express your thoughts in the most profound way. Now we can't even grasp Sanskrit today. Most people cannot understand Sanskrit today because the capacity of mind, of our mind, has declined tremendously. Now imagine the people who invented this language, how much developed their mind would have been. That mind would have been a super mind. It could not be an ordinary mind which can actually invent a language like Sanskrit. That is why it is called Devvani. Devvani means it was given birth by Devtas. Devtas basically means the people or the entities which have, you know, very divine power, which have tremendous amount of, you know, higher consciousness, which can be translated into different forms. So the language, Sanskrit language, was given birth by what we call Devtas. That is why it is called Devvani. So I think today I would like to stop here. Just let me conclude this language part a little bit more. It is very well established that there are seven different branches of Indo-European languages. And all these branches, they have their origin from Sanskrit. Sanskrit is the mother language, and all these seven branches of European languages, whether they are Slavic branches or they, whether they are, you know, what we Germanic languages, or whether they are other languages, the Latin languages in Europe, they have all their origin in Sanskrit. And this has been clearly established by different Western writers, including Max Müller, including, you know, so many others. So I wanted to give a brief outline on these four aspects today. We will go on the other aspects slowly, slowly in our next presentations. So this is just to give an idea. This is a, you know, comparatively fairly long presentation on which we'll go slowly, slowly. But you know, this kind of presentation would be very useful for younger generation in our country, so that they can get an idea of our heritage and of what our ancestors gave to this world. So I would stop here, and if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them before we go for our meditation session.